On behalf of Institute and Alumni Office, I welcome you all for the 10th session of Saturday Musings. This is a forum of interaction for faculty, students, and industry experts. As you all know, today is the topic is understanding the entrepreneurial mindset. To lay the context, I would like to welcome Mr. S.Parthasarathy, Head of Alumni Office.
A warm welcome to all of you. I think we are already running 15 minutes late. Let us lay the context. My role is to lay the context. So let's quickly do a small activity. Some of you would have this plain sheet of paper, which you probably collected at the registration desk. Yeah? And if you have a pen, pencil, whatever. Yeah? So I want you to do me a favor.
I'd like you to draw a scenery, whatever comes to your mind. Yeah? Draw a scenery. Those of you who have this small white sheet of paper, draw a scenery. Small activity, 4-5 minutes, then we'll move on. You have a pen, draw a scenery. If you don't have a paper, visualize it in your mind. Yeah. I hope 30 seconds should suffice. You can close your eyes if you wish to visualize. We are through? Yeah? Would you like to compare what you have drawn with your neighbor, the nearest neighbor, and just check out what you have done? And would you like to just show your drawing? Yeah? Okay. Okay. Okay, I see a lot of common denominators. Okay. So I see most of them have drawn a couple of hills and a sun and a river, a house, common elements of your scenery. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, so maybe even you'd like to, those of you who don't, who probably haven't done it on a paper, you can discuss. So what are you thinking right now? So when you see the other person's scenery and you see a lot of common denominators between what two people have done, so what's coming to your mind? Any thoughts? Quick thoughts? Pardon me? Okay. You think alike and therefore maybe that's why you're different? Yeah?
Yes, different. My neighbor here drawn C.
Okay.
And I come from hill, so I have a
okay. You're conditioned by your past experience. Yes. Wonderful. Yeah? Anything else, anyone else would like to quickly share? Any thoughts around this activity? Yeah? Any thoughts? Okay, sure. So this is a small activity to demonstrate the fact that most of us, the behavioral patterns that we actually follow in day-to-day life, consciously, unconsciously, we seem to be following some patterns that you can trace to your childhood. And maybe when you were children, that is the last time you probably drew a scenery, right? And in the intervening period, last probably couple of decades, you even had the opportunity to probably draw scenery. If not, you'd have iteratively taken the data point streams and worked on how else you can do it differently. But now that after 20 years you've been asked to draw scenery, the first thing that comes to your mind, maybe somewhere in the cortical region, you pick out that memory and it says draw two hills and a sun and river and house, etc. That's the way the mind works, isn't it? So a lot of things that we do today is conditioned by your past experiences, memories, your vicarious experience or real experience, even by imaginary experience, fantasies, hallucinations. Yeah, today's topic is very fascinating. It's all about mindsets. It's all about mindsets. And one of the things that we are trying to understand now is how do entrepreneurs think, feel, behave, under different circumstances. Are there any insights for us to understand and learn and check out if there is something different about the entrepreneurial journey? And we have a lovely session lined up today. We have a talk by a faculty, followed by two panel discussions. One is the ringside view. We need to give it a name, interesting name. Ringside view and inside view. What entrepreneurs think about what they do, and what people who have been observing entrepreneurs do, what do they think about the entrepreneurial mindset? Yeah. Thank you for participating in the small activity. Let me cut it to the chase and quickly introduce the faculty. Professor K.Kumar is a chairperson, academic programs at NSR Cell, and he is also taking over as the Dean, Alumni Relations and Development, starting from 1st April, another week to 10 days' time. He has over 16 years of experience. Please. He has over 16 years of experience in the industry, holding positions of CEO, President, and Management Consultant in reputed organizations. He has also started three companies before joining IIMB in 2001. He is an alumnus of IIMB PGP class of 81 and FEM class of 92. In this context, I'd also like to welcome Professor Prasanna Chandra. He is one of our revered professors. Some of you might know him, some of you of the finance stream, very kind enough to have, you know, taken time off to come here today. Thank you, sir, and welcome back to the campus.
A very good morning to all of you. And thank you, Partha, for inviting me to be here. As Partha mentioned, that I'm going to take over the responsibility for IIMB Alumni Association shortly from now. So I'm going to very closely work with Partha. And Partha couldn't have found a better way of testing my mettle to play that role. Because he called me today saying that, yeah, alumni will all be there, you come and speak. And without me knowing, he put my guru in front of me. And Professor Prasanna Chandra was the chairman of my PhD thesis advisory committee. And I couldn't have faced a sterner test to get into this role than what he have done to me today. But nevertheless, I'm sure Professor Prasanna Chandra's training of me would not have gone waste. And hopefully I'll give a good account of myself during this talk this morning. And in any case, I couldn't have asked for a better occasion to sort of meet the alumni and then set the stage for my future interactions with all of you in my new role. But today, my role is going to be essentially to talk about the entrepreneurial mindset. As many of you probably know that I have been associated with IIMB in my role at NSR Cell for almost right from the year 2001. It's almost 17 years of association at NSR Cell with the entrepreneurs, with all the programs which we do for entrepreneurs and the engagements we have with them. And of course, that was preceded by a few years of my own dabbling into entrepreneurship and starting a few companies. But with all this, if I wake up in the morning and ask myself, what do I know about entrepreneurial mindset, the answer is a little bit unnerving. There is so much happening on the field of entrepreneurship, both in terms of practice and in terms of, from the academic perspective, in terms of understanding in very abstract terms, what do entrepreneurs do, how do they think, and how do they manage to achieve what they seek to achieve. It's a kind of growing body of knowledge, and we are discovering newer and newer facets day in and day out. And the journey is far from complete, and we have just scratched the surface of this phenomenon. And what I'll be sharing with you in the next 15-20 minutes is to see whatever I have understood so far, and I've tried to couch it into a framework which makes sense to me. It's more my way of thinking, which is not necessarily the way you all need to understand. But hopefully, I'll leave behind a few snippets of thoughts for you to build on and then reflect on as you leave this discussion. So I'll start with, why do we even care about entrepreneurship at this point in time? In fact, since all of us are alumni, this sets the right context for us to address this question. Partha gave out some years of, my PGP years. I graduated in 1981. And when I graduated, the term entrepreneurship was rarely used in the first couple of years of the PGP, which we did. It was more incidental to the discussion. And when I started my first company in 1983, which I eventually sold in 1986. The only reason I sold that company at that time was that I didn't have enough capital to invest for the growth of that business. And the term venture capital, I had not even heard at that time in 1986. We only had a few public financing institutions like the Karnataka State Financing Corporations. At the national level, you had IDBI, ICICI, and institutions like that. But the whole concept of risk capital was completely unknown to entrepreneurs at that time. So the only choice you had was either you go around, put together resources from the friends, family, and fools. You know, that's what people say. And if you run out of luck, and then you just don't have a choice but to sort of exit and go on in life and do other things. That's how the entrepreneurship grew. But coming into the new millennium, the kind of support, the kind of interest that has happened, that has been built around entrepreneurship is something phenomenal. And it also has its own side effects in terms of blurring the real concept of entrepreneurship and then embedding with a lot of frills, bells, and whistles, which makes it extremely difficult to understand this concept for what it really is. So that is the exercise which I'm going to take up today to sort of demystify this concept. And given that all of us share a very similar background, so I'm going to draw on the existing knowledge base you all have to put certain thoughts in your mind in terms of how to view this phenomenon and how to relate to it. Why are we talking about entrepreneurship today? It's because entrepreneurship in its essence is about dealing with uncertainty, right? And the world is becoming increasingly uncertain with so many discontinuous changes happening, which was not the norm even a few decades ago. In fact, if I look at my father's generation, I have seen people entering an organization and retiring from that organization after 35, 40 years of service with practically no change in their professional life. And you can possibly say the same thing about social life, family life, everything. But if you think back about the last 15 to 20 years, the kind of changes that we are facing is immense. And that's some of the trends which I have captured here: digitalization, the demographic dynamics across different nations, across different geographies. Then you're talking about the various economic and social cultural upheavals. You're all observing what is happening in Europe today. And of course, finally, the new rules on the personal, social, and economic life, which sort of seem to be redefining the way we live our life. If you are essentially trying to cope up with all this uncertainty, what you're essentially doing is you're thinking very differently, and that thought process is something which is very, very akin to the entrepreneurial thought process, because in essence, entrepreneurs also deal with uncertainty, okay? So in a very uncertain world, if there is any school of thought, any way of thinking that is going to help us, it is going to be this entrepreneurial thinking. So I draw this analogy at a very macro level right up front, and then I'll go on to talk about what is this logic, what is this mindset that helps us to deal with uncertainty. That's what I'm going to do next. Okay. Now, there is one phenomenon which we have been seeing over the years, is that more and more people are getting drawn towards this idea of entrepreneurship and making attempts at being entrepreneurs or trying something entrepreneurial. If you sit back and ask the question, what triggers this entrepreneurial thinking in the minds of people, you come to certain two broad patterns, okay? And these two patterns together drive a lot of research on understanding the entrepreneurial phenomenon. And they probably explain a broad spectrum of entrepreneurial activities that happen all around the world. The first trigger is like this. The first thing what triggers an entrepreneur is that they see a deep disconnect between the world in which they would like to live and the world in which they are living today. Okay, that is the first trigger. That means you're looking at what is possible, and then you're looking at what is existing, and how do I fill the gap? And that is the first trigger for any kind of entrepreneurial thinking. If you bring it down to the specifics, you can look at some of these trends which are happening in the world. First is you're talking about digitalization, right? At one level, you try to understand these technologies, and you also know that how these technologies can change the way people live and change the way the world exists. And you look around and see what we are doing currently, and then that gap is sought to be filled through your efforts, through your ideas. That is your first trigger for entrepreneurship. You can talk about it in very different spheres also. For example, if you look at some of the bigger problems we face with relation to entrepreneurship, sustainability, etc., all of them ultimately feed into your vision of what the world can be and what it is today, and how do I fill the gap, and that is the trigger for entrepreneurship. So I have captured a few trends over here in relation to environment, in relation to social inequalities, in relation to the possibilities promoted by science and technology and new discovery of knowledge. And all these things give you a trigger in terms of what you can do entrepreneurially by latching onto some of these trends, latching onto some more pieces of knowledge that come your way. And how can you use that to develop products and services which can help you to create the world in which you want to live in? And that, to me, is one of the most significant triggers of entrepreneurial thinking. What the Western researchers call this phenomena is as the opportunity-driven entrepreneurship, because you see that opportunity to fill the gap between the ideal world and the currently existing world, and you start working towards that, and that is opportunity-seeking entrepreneurship. But this is not the only trigger. At the other end of the spectrum, you also find the sheer necessity which drives entrepreneurial thinking in you. Okay, this is completely at the opposite end of entrepreneurial triggers, entrepreneurial thinking. And you can see a lot of people who, because of sheer necessity, think very entrepreneurially and then indulge in entrepreneurial activities. I had the good fortune to visit Israel to understand the Israel startup ecosystem, made a couple of visits in the recent years. The more you listen to their narrative about how the country has come to be called as a startup nation, you find the role of the sheer necessity that country faces as a small piece of land, completely surrounded by very, very aggressive and hostile neighbors with practically no resources to talk about it available within that land. And this combination spurs them in different ways and different levels to be very entrepreneurial. That is one level of necessity. On the other level, if you really look at our own country, if you look at our neighborhood, the everyday entrepreneurs whom you see on the road, they are a perfect embodiment of necessity triggering the entrepreneurial instinct in them. When I drive past Silk Road every morning, when I sort of accelerate my car after seeing the green light, I look at this guy on a bicycle, rolling that bicycle with 100 coconuts on either side, charging straight at me and then trying to dodge me. I don't see a rule breaker there in him. I see an entrepreneur in him. That guy wants to make a decent living, and he wants to live a life of dignity, and the system is not designed taking his needs into consideration, and he is fighting all odds because he has a necessity to do so, and what he does to me is the height of entrepreneurship. So you have two people at the ends of the spectrum, one who leverage the latest of knowledge, the latest of scientific discoveries to create something of immense value, who probably will show up as IPO companies in Wall Street and then take away millions and billions home. At the other end of the spectrum, you see these guys who use their entrepreneurial instinct to live a life of dignity. So today's world requires both of them, and that is the broad spectrum of entrepreneurial behavior we are seeing day in and day out. Okay, now that we know that both these people could be categorized into one group as entrepreneurs, what is the commonality in their underlying thought process? What is this entrepreneurship all about? As a process, what does it mean? As an activity, what does it mean? Let me try to sort of address that question. While doing so, I'll go beyond the popular discourse, what we hear from magazines, and, you know, news channels, and public forums. So there's a lot of dialogue going on, but I'll try to go beyond that. Entrepreneurship in its essential brass tacks is an act of creating something new. And how do you do that? Under conditions of very limited resources, and without any consideration to, resources you are currently controlling. That means you don't start by asking what is the resources I have, but you start with the goal of creating something new. And you don't try to speculate how much of resources you know, whether you have it or not, should I be attempting that or not. No, you don't do that, but instead you use your own creativity and innovation to create something new without regard to resources currently in control. This is essentially what entrepreneurship is all about. So if this is the essence of entrepreneurship, can everybody do it? Or is there a particular method or a particular thought process that helps you to do what is apparently looking to be a kind of a undoable thing or a kind of a challenging thing? So that's where we talk about the entrepreneurial mindset and the method. So let me address these two separately, because the method refers to a process, the mindset refers to a kind of a mental preparation to attempt that task. So I'll start by the mental preparation in terms of how, what kind of a worldview you deploy to think very entrepreneurially. Okay? The first is that you have to believe that you have a responsibility to create the world that proves to be better for you and also for the future generations. It is not just toying with the possibilities of having a better world, but you assuming the responsibility to create that better world. That is what entrepreneurs believe. The one thing you will never find in any entrepreneur is the sense of indifference. Why do I care? No, they care. They care for the world which they think would be a better place to live in for themselves and their future generations. And they also go on to feel that it is their responsibility to create that world. So that is the essence of entrepreneurial mindset. It's one of the important ingredients of a mindset. The second is that the entrepreneurs believe they are not alone in this task. They co-create this world along with others, people who share similar dreams, who share similar views of the world which they share. And then that means they have this kind of a sense of the multiplicative effect of combining forces with others. They choose to co-create. That is the second mindset. They are not loners and they are not greedy in that sense. They would like to create more and share more with others. That is the second aspect of the entrepreneurial mindset. The third aspect is the entrepreneurs strongly believe their actions matter, because all of us have great ideas about how the world should shape, should be, but then very few of us act on those ideas. The entrepreneurs put a lot of premium on the action. They don't worry about how significant or insignificant their actions are, but whatever be their actions matter in creating a better world. Okay, so that is the belief in their actions. And finally, they also are willing to deal with uncertainty and they believe it is inevitable. What does it mean? They don't care much about the outcome. If the outcome works the way they visualize it to be, so be it, good for them. If the outcome is not something which they visualize and if it is not happening, they will just move on. So they are willing to accept that uncertainty, accept the uncertainty involved in the outcomes. Nevertheless, they are willing to act, try, work with others and imagine a different world. That is at a very high level. That is an entrepreneurial mindset. Now, how do they translate this mindset into an entrepreneurial activity or an entrepreneurial pursuit? That is where we are talking about an entrepreneurial method. Do they do things in a way very different from many of us are trained to do? The answer has been yes. In fact, gone are the days, maybe about 30, 40 years ago, when you talk to many of the people who try to understand entrepreneurs and understand entrepreneurship, the early days of research was sort of focusing more on the personality traits of entrepreneurs, as if trying to prove that entrepreneurs are born with a certain type of traits, and then that's what makes them ultimately succeed. It is all about things like, you know, achievement orientation, internal locus of control, and so many other things which they talked about from the psychology school. But increasingly, a lot of research has happened centering around asking the question, what is it about what the good entrepreneurs do or a successful entrepreneurs do that can be absorbed and taught to everybody else so that everybody has a fair chance of creating something new? So when the question was framed that way, a lot of interesting research happened. That surprisingly has led to an understanding that the entrepreneurial method is very, very different from the methods which we adopt to run a conventional or a matured business. In the language of Silicon Valley, the contemporary language of Silicon Valley, when most of the time when we are managing current businesses, we are dealing with an entity which has acquired a size of n. Whereas the entrepreneurs go from 0 to 1 and then multiply 1 into n and then they reach a very matured organization. So the thought process which entrepreneurs deploy to go from 0 to 1 is very different from the thought process which we are expected to employ when we are managing an entity which has already acquired the size of n. So how do they go from 0 to 1? One of our colleagues, Professor Saraswati, who is Jamuna Raghavan Chair Professor of Entrepreneurship at IIM, she has done extensive work and she has come up with a set of theoretical principles branded under effectuation, which is increasingly gaining traction and acceptance among scholars worldwide. And I have shared this kind of this theory with many, many audiences, and every time I have done this and people have really, particularly the entrepreneurs, see themselves in the way this theory explains their behavior. So it comes as close to the reality as possible. What do the entrepreneurs do? There are a set of principles. the first of all, the entrepreneurs work with the bird in hand. Okay, they don't consider the universe of possibilities and then try to pick the best possible goal which they can set for themselves. Putting it in very simple terms, creating a permanent cure for cancer is probably one of the best payoffs the society can expect. But a typical entrepreneur will not worry about it if he doesn't have a solution for that. Even if he has found a herb in the backyard of his house which treats common cold, and if he thinks that's not available in the market, the entrepreneur will continue to work with that. That means you look for opportunities which are within your reach and don't necessarily look for the universe of opportunities and try to choose the best from them. So they use this bird in hand principle. What is the next thing to do? The entrepreneurs, contrary to what we all believe and what we in business schools teach in terms of return on investment, they don't really do those calculations when they attempt an entrepreneurial task. What they essentially do is that they know that they are dealing with extreme uncertainty and there is no guarantee of any particular outcome they can achieve. All that they do to move from one stage of action to another is to see, whatever I expend now, if I completely lose it, can I still stand up and run? That means the entire mindset is one of calculating the affordable loss and work within the limits of those affordable loss, rather than going and do an exotic calculation of return on investment with all your spreadsheets and the attendant calisthenics and then getting at that magic number, sort of, you know, supported by whole set of hollow assumptions. They don't do that. They essentially look at, I'm sure to lose everything which I'm going to expend in going to the next stage. If I do lose it, can I stand up and then get on with life? That is all they do. If the answer is yes, they go on to the next stage. They do whatever they have to do. The third thing they do is they welcome contingencies. In fact, in our planning school, we are all taught to imagine all possible things that can go wrong with a plan and cover for every one of those exigencies, either with extra resources, padding, cushions, plan Bs, plan C, everything. Whereas entrepreneurs accept that the inevitables will happen, the unexpected events will happen, and they're not scared of that. If anything, they say, how can I take advantage of these unexpected events to work in my favor to further my goal or even to change my goal? The next thing they do is they're very, very open for co-creation in the sense they work with others, which we normally don't associate entrepreneurs with. Even some of the heroic stories which we get in the popular press also point to some of those odd individuals who have steadfastly refused to co-create, but an average entrepreneur always co-creates. In fact, one of the entrepreneurs came to my class, MBA class, and he was addressing the students, and one of the students got up and asked, why should I share my idea with other people when I'm working on it? Because they might steal that idea, so I should not be sharing that. So the entrepreneur answered him saying, people have better things to do than stealing your ideas. Okay, that was his first answer. The second answer was that your idea is great only to you. That doesn't mean it's great to everybody else. They may just dismiss it saying this is a stupid idea and then walk away, right? So you don't run the risk anyway. If your good fortune is that the other person is also thinking it's a great idea, their first instinct would be to work with you rather than undercut you. So entrepreneurs always think that how I can work with others and co-create and work on opportunities rather than keep things to myself and then shorten the size of the pie. Then the next thing to do, so this is actually a kind of an umbrella principle. What they believe is that since the world, the task which they are attempting is so full of uncertainty, and they are going to be in the forefront of dealing with that uncertainty, they eschew a lot of planning. They instead focus a lot on action. To the extent they are going to be in control, they don't waste too much of time sitting back and predicting what all can go right and what all can go wrong. And their belief is, to the extent that I'm going to be in the scene of action, when things go right, I'll be there to take advantage of that. When things go wrong, I'll be there to correct the course, so I don't have to sit back and wait. I mean, waste my time in predicting what is going to happen in the future, because prediction is anyway impossible given the level of uncertainty that I face when I'm trying to do something new. Okay, now, this together, the entrepreneurial, the big mindset, as well as the methods which they follow, gives you a good sense of how the entrepreneurial journey or the entrepreneurial task is very different from what we normally do in the course of normal business management or managing very matured activities. Now, where do we go from here? If you understand this, then the next question is that how do you sort of imbibe this entrepreneurial mindset on a larger scale, across the society. Okay, that is the next important question. And there, we have to think of this entrepreneurial mindset beyond individuals. Sure, it is important to imbibe this mindset in the minds of the individual, but then individuals alone can't do this. You have to look at it beyond the individual. So in that sense, now we ask another question, who can be entrepreneurial? Sure, all of us as individual persons, we can be entrepreneurial, but then there are a lot of different combinations in which we can be entrepreneurial. You start with the individuals, and then you also have communities which are entrepreneurial. I'm sure those of you who live in Bangalore, you must have heard of this small group of people. I forget the name of what they call themselves. They find a particular part of the city or a part of a neighborhood very dirty. In the middle of the night, they go without telling anybody, just clean it up. And the next morning, you go there and the place is absolutely clean. Ugly Indians. Okay? This is an entrepreneurial community. Okay? A big group of people come together and they see that their part of the world can be better. And they know their action can make a difference, and then they just go on and do it. That's it, right? So as communities, you can be very entrepreneurial. As corporations, you can be entrepreneurial. You know, people keep talking about Googles and the 3Ms and organizations like that, which are iconic in their approach to entrepreneurship. So as corporations, you can be very entrepreneurial, right? Then you can also be, as governments, you can be entrepreneurial. In fact, I was referring to you about Israel, so I had an opportunity to meet some of the political leaders and ministers who were in office. And even they speak the language of entrepreneurship. And if you look at their language, the way they speak, they say, we are very entrepreneurial as a nation. We can do this. Nothing is impossible for us. The kind of thought process they have. And that has been translated to some extent closer home also. For example, what defines this current national government from many of the previous government is that a prime minister goes to the podium and talks about how it is important for the entire country to be very entrepreneurial. So the governments can be entrepreneurial. Then you can also have imaginative societies and action groups. And in fact, I can even refer to one of our colleagues, Professor Trilochan Sastri, who started this ADR, which is a classic case of a group of people who believed in certain things and then created an entrepreneurial effort around it. And because of their effort, today we get so much of detail about the candidates whom we have to vote for, and that is part of their initiative. Now, if once you see that different agglomeration of people can be entrepreneurial in different formats, then the next question, the larger question is that how do you embed this entrepreneurial thinking across all these diverse entities and groups of people and organizations? That is where the concept of ecosystem comes in. And the ecosystem has a lot of elements. You've got networks, leadership, finance, talent, etc. All of them together contribute to different kinds of entrepreneurial activities at different levels. And then you try to get the outcome. This is the conventional or the theoretical way of looking at the ecosystem. But what does it mean to you and me as an ecosystem? The way we frame this question is, do entrepreneurs act alone? Yes, the individual effort of entrepreneur, their initiative or their passion, zeal is extremely important. But as you have seen in the previous discussions, that alone is not good enough. It is a necessary condition, but it is not a sufficient condition. These entrepreneurs have to work with a bunch of stakeholders. It doesn't just take an entrepreneur with an idea to build a business. He needs a customer who is willing to take a bet on the entrepreneur's new product. He needs a supplier who is willing to back him up when he doesn't have any customers to start with. He needs an employee who would like to work with him when the company doesn't even have a revenue. That means an entrepreneur's success is dependent on all the actors in the ecosystem. So if you put it that way, then you also have to support them with the right kind of framework conditions, which means it will be cultural conditions, it could be legal, regulatory, whatever you have. We should support and recognize the kind of activities they do and then make sure they are supported in that. Okay? Some of the biggest challenges in this is that the one unresolved question from a research point of view is that which comes first? Do the entrepreneurs make the ecosystem or do the ecosystem generate these kind of successful entrepreneurs? It's a vexed question. It's a kind of an iterative loop. We haven't figured out where to start, how to break this vicious circle. We haven't done that. The second is that can ecosystems be replicated, even if you find that Silicon Valley works very well, but the popular observation is that even within the US, they have not been able to replicate Silicon Valley, forget anywhere else in the world. Not even in the US, Silicon Valley has been replicated. So how do you create these vibrant ecosystems which will support entrepreneurship? That's a big question. And finally, after doing all that, what is it for? We started by saying, entrepreneurs imagine a better world, a world which they are not part of and they would like to create. Are you really going to realize that world? What are the ifs and buts over there? That is where there is a lot of paradox between the micro level entrepreneurial activity and the macro level impact you are expecting out of entrepreneurship. One is, I'll start with the macro level, the nations. Why should countries care about entrepreneurship? Let me give you a couple of examples. You know, the growth theory in economics talks about the higher the percentage of GDP a country spends on science, research, and development, the higher should be the economic growth rate. But in the entire period of the 80s and 90s, Sweden experienced something very different. They were the highest spenders in terms of percentage of GDP on science, technology, and research and development. They had one of the lowest growth rates amongst developed countries. And this was a vexing paradox for them. And then they, of course, did a lot of work called expert economists like Odrish and all. They looked at the whole scenario, and then they figured out Sweden is one of those countries. On the one hand, they used to spend a lot on research and development. On the other hand, they were also a welfare state. That means if you're a citizen of Sweden, you don't have to worry about your life at all because your life is completely taken care of in good times, bad times, everything. So there was no incentive or no motivation for people to stretch themselves. On the other hand, there is a lot of knowledge getting created, but this knowledge getting converted into useful products and services warranted that individuals had to stretch themselves in the face of uncertainty by using their own initiative to take action. They thought that was missing, and they call it the Swedish paradox. And because of that, the Sweden embarked on a whole lot of entrepreneurial activities, and today Sweden is very different from the Sweden of 90s. That is where nations start caring about entrepreneurship. I already talked about Israel. You know the conditions, and for them, the defense, the water conservation, agriculture with very limited water, these are all technologies which sort of propel them at a national level to think about entrepreneurship. The third one you have is the USA in the post-2008 financial crisis. Everybody wrote off United States saying this is the beginning of the end of United States. And come 2017, you know what is happening today. In fact, one of our former colleagues, Amar Bide, wrote a brilliant book about US saying that the greatness of US is not about how many new ideas they generate. In fact, he went on to point out some of the path-breaking ideas in the modern era did not originate within US, whether it is internet, whether it is a browser, whether it was Skype. You think of any of these life-changing products which you are using even today, none of them originated in the US. But the greatness of the United States is the ability of that community to absorb new innovations and make it a part of their life. And that's what would fuel US growth, which is turning out to be true even today. And then, finally, we talk about India also. Around by mid-95, many of us wrote us off saying that liberalization is going to kill all the Indian entrepreneurs. But then today you look back and then see how many new entrepreneurs have sprung up because of the liberalization and how many of the old business houses have gained in strength post-liberalization because their entrepreneurial spirits have been completely unleashed by unentangling all the regulations. So nations think of entrepreneurship. It's important at a macro level to create impact. But the next question is that if all countries want to promote entrepreneurship, then what kind of entrepreneurship should you promote? If you listen to the modern discourse on entrepreneurship, everybody would say that you start a business and you rapidly scale it up, you know, make it really large. But then look at the evidence. Are large companies job creators? There is enough research which tells you the large companies are efficiency seekers and they progressively keep eliminating jobs by using technology, right? That means, should you be promoting only those entrepreneurs who can really scale things up so that they stop creating jobs? Or should you create other alternative kind of entrepreneurs? Look at the next question. Do all entrepreneurs create jobs? Another big question, because at the high level, we assume that entrepreneurship means creating more jobs. India has close to about 40 million enterprises who do not employ anybody other than their own family. That is the kind of enterprises we run. There is no employment here. It's only family employment, that all the members of the family work in those enterprises. Then that becomes, if that is the predominant model in a country like India, then what is the role of entrepreneurship there? That takes us to the next question. What is the role of this necessity-based entrepreneurship, the coconut wala whom I was talking about? What is his role in the entire ecosystem of entrepreneurship? how does he complement or conflict with the high growth entrepreneurship or the gazelles as we call them? Do they have a role? You can think about it. The answers can vary depending upon what kind of a lineage you have and the worldview you have. Personally speaking, to me, I would say that without these entrepreneurs, a country with so much of diversity and so much of disparity would very soon descend into chaos if these guys don't have a decent way of earning their living through their entrepreneurship. That's how I would look at it. And finally, this is an unanswered question, or not even unsurfaced question, in all entrepreneurship policies. What do we do with failed entrepreneurs? Because the statistics tells you that every entrepreneurial venture is not going to succeed. There are a whole lot of them who are going to fail. How is the society going to rehabilitate them? That's one part. More importantly, how are we going to harvest the knowledge which they acquire in the process of failing and then reinvest that knowledge into more productive entrepreneurship? So that is another question which we need to ask in terms of planning for entrepreneurship or using the service. Okay, how do we nurture entrepreneurial mindset? Assuming that entrepreneurship is good for the society, how do we do that? One is you have to catch them young. So the time has come when entrepreneurship education has to become a part of a general education and not just the preview of a few people who dare to try to do something new as an entrepreneur. In fact, I'm very happy to tell you, because you are an alumni group, IIMB is one of the first IIMs to have a core course in entrepreneurship, and coming from the next academic year, we are increasing the number of credits of the core course from 1.5 to 3 credits. That means we are going to have a full 3-credit course in entrepreneurship. Starting from the coming academic year, 2019, IIMB will be the first IIM to offer a PhD program exclusively specializing in entrepreneurship. Okay, this is at the higher education level. But what is important is we have to make entrepreneurship education the general education. I do some work with the technical training institutes. And there, if you know that the National Skilling Program talks about skilling 500 million people without talking about where will the jobs for all of them come from. There is never in our history have we created jobs of that number. That means every one of them are ultimately going to become entrepreneurs. And what are we doing to educate them to live the life of an entrepreneur? That's a big open question now, right? The second is that teach entrepreneurship not in a very episodic way by showing some of the role models or who have succeeded, but teach it as a systematic method using the principles of effectuation, using the principles of lean canvas and various other tools which have proven to be very, very valuable for entrepreneurship in their practice. The third principle is that encourage entrepreneurs to develop their own yardstick of success without succumbing to the externally imposed norms. You are still an entrepreneur worth your salt even if you don't get funded by a venture capitalist. Even if you don't take your company IPO, you still are doing a lot of value creation for yourself, and do it because after all it is a life of passion. So you define your own norms of what success means to you and then chase that success rather than succumbing to these kind of an external norms. Okay, I'll skip this part because in the interest of time, we are running out of time. So I'll skip this part, I'll just go to the summary now. Okay. I was tempted to talk about corporate, because we're all, most of us are involved in corporate organizations, but in the interest of time, I'll skip that. So I'll just summarize by saying what entrepreneurial mindset is. It is an iron will and determination to create a world that we want us and our future generations to be in. With that kind of a lofty idea, that is the springing board for entrepreneurial mindset. An action orientation with a focus on the doable and pushing the envelope all the time, and then shaping the outcomes as they emerge. An inclusive intent to co-opt others, because after all, if you're talking about a world which we and the future generations want to live in, it is not a world which will be personally owned by us. It's a world which is going to be shared by everybody else. So get everybody to share the effort and then co-create with them. That is the entrepreneurial mindset. And finally, an open mind to leverage the unexpected, which uncertainty throws at you all the time. Leverage the unexpected to support the creative endeavor. In summary, this is, to me, is what entrepreneurial mindset is all about. Thank you for your listening.
Thank you once again, sir. We'll start with the first panel. Your sights on what makes you tick, inside view, moderated by Mr. Parthasarathy, alumnus of IIMB class of PGP 94 and an author of Unmet Needs of Entrepreneurship. We have a first panelist, Mr. Saumil Majumdar, alumnus of IIMB class of PGP 95, is a co-founder and CEO of Managing Director of SportzVillage. A small brief introduction about him. Director of SportzVillage, India's leading grassroots sports organization. As an entrepreneur since 98, Saumil has experienced various stages of business, including dealing with multiple failures, building a team, raising funds from angels and institutions, pivoting to find a product market fit, trying multiple business models, and finally building a sustainable and scalable SportzVillage business that today helps 1 million people experience the magic of sport. Saumil represented EduSport on India's leading social activism platform on television, Amir Khan's Satyameva Jayate sports episode, where EduSports was chosen as sustainable and scalable model of getting children to play. He has also received the CII Emerging Entrepreneur Award and has been recognized as one of the top 50 leaders influencing education by Education World. Welcome to you, sir. Our next panelist is Ms. Rachna Rao. She is an alumnus of IIMB class of PGP 2006, co-founder of FoodyBuddy. FoodyBuddy, a platform for home chefs to share authentic delicacies with foodies in their neighborhood. Earlier, she worked in IT services for about 5 years after graduating from IIMB and joined Zynga as a product manager in 2012 and was head of the product for games like Formula 1 and 2. Though she loved her job at Zynga, but once the idea stuck for FoodyBuddy came to her, she knew she would have to quit and make FoodyBuddy happen. Welcome to you, ma'am. Our next panelist is Yamini Bhat, alumnus of IIMB class of PGP 2007. She's a co-founded Vymo in 2013 to enhance sales efficiency and productivity, and has since led the company's operations as CEO. She was previously engagement manager at McKinsey & Company, where she specialized in marketing strategy and sales and distribution. Welcome to you, ma'am. Next panelist is Mr. Ganesh Balakrishnan, alumnus of IIMB class of PGP 2008. He's the co-founder and CMO of Momoe, the mobile payments app that enables payments at restaurants and retail stores. Momoe raised a seed funding of $1.2 million and has expanded to Bangalore and Pune, and then was acquired by ShopClues.com. Ganesh then transitioned into ShopClues as a VP of the merchant ecosystem, expanding and managing the largest merchant marketplace with 6 lakh merchants. He has an engineering and business background with 4 years of entrepreneurial experience at ShopClues, Momoe, Windsleeves, and Fab Living. Ganesh devotes his non-working time with his wife and 6-year-old daughter. He is presently in process of starting up once again and also teaching entrepreneurship at NID Ahmedabad, Bangalore, and IIM Tirchi. Welcome to you, sir.
You know, at the outset, it's wonderful to have alums back on campus. Some excuse or the other, we get them back somehow. So let's start off the conversation. To begin with, I'd like to understand your entrepreneurial journey. What is it about entrepreneurship that is exciting for you, and what made you get into entrepreneurship in the first place? Saumil, you want to start? Yeah.
First of all, thank you for inviting me, and pleasure to be here in front of senior professors. Enjoyed Professor Kumar's presentation. But you know, he gave a lot of high value things to entrepreneurship. I don't think I had any of those. I did it because I had fun. I mean, it was fun. And fun not in a party way, fun not in a fun because it is tough. If it's a juicy enough problem to solve, it's fun. So I think that's one key element in my view, that is it worth doing? Is it difficult enough? And if it is, then it's fun, and then you keep doing it.
Okay.
So for me, it's just been fun as one important element that I would submit to him to add into his
framework.
framework. It's an important thing, and fun keeps you going.
That's right. That's right. Rachna?
Hi. Firstly, it's great to be here. This Audi has so many memories. They're all just coming back. So I actually never thought I would be an entrepreneur. I never consciously thought that, you know, I need to start up and do my own thing. For me, the reason why I did this was the idea came to me and then it just never went away. I just had to make FoodyBuddy happen. For me, primarily, you know, quoting from Professor Kumar's slides again, I really felt that FoodyBuddy could make a difference, give a platform to, you know, hundreds of thousands of people who cook well, give them a platform for people to experience their cooking, give them feedback and gain recognition. And personally, as you know, I think there are a lot of working couples who just don't have time to cook, don't have time to coordinate with a cook, don't know how to cook themselves. So for me, and my husband, who's also one of my co-founders, was very passionate about the concept of shared economy. So the idea just came to us, you know, why not shared economy for home-cooked food? And then it just happened. I mean, there was no conscious thought process that, you know, I want to start up. I just knew that this had to happen, found two amazing co-founders, and then it happened.
Yamini?
So hi, I'm Yamini. Thanks for inviting us back to campus. It's amazing to be here. We just had our 10-year reunion, and I was wondering why we don't come here much, much more often. It's, for starters, it's much more breathable air once in a while. So I'm one of the co-founders of Vymo. Vymo is what we call a personal sales assistant. The goal is to keep predicting what a salesperson should do next. It's a solution for enterprises. So prior to that, I was having a very good career gig at McKinsey. I think what pushed me to start up something on my own is probably I'm a workaholic. You can't stop me from working. I think right after this, I have a meeting with a client in Koramangala and so on. So I love pouring myself into something and creating value. I think it's very tough to, I usually pour 200% of myself into something, and it's very tough to see when only 10-15% of that converts into value. Not because any company is not great to work with, McKinsey is an amazing place to work with, but you're trying to have impact with end clients through a team. So it's two steps away from actually where action happens, and while you truly pour 200% of yourself into it, it gets diluted when it hits the ground. So that pace was just, I just felt I needed to capture the 190% also. And it just felt like every minute, everything, every action that I do, it can be done much faster. My learning can be much faster too, and it can be converted into much greater value. That pushed me off the bus. Now, what I actually latched on to was a completely different story and how I came into that insight. But basically, I was driving sales transformation for multiple enterprises at McKinsey. It was pretty obvious that clients are willing to pay millions of dollars for someone to come and tell them how to improve their sales conversions or sales per salesperson, etc. And any kind of tools that we had, that clients had invested into at that point in time, were just not giving them the results. And we as consultants were trying to do it in a very, very tedious manual way, trying to nudge, train, coach, etc. So it just felt like there is an obvious gap there which needed to be addressed by a product, and that gave the idea. But ultimately, it's more about if I'm willing to pour everything of myself into something, but that has to create tremendous value. It was that thought that pushed me into this.
Thank you very much for inviting us. Good morning to be here. Good weekend. Partly agree with all of you guys here. It's a matter of fun. It's a matter of, you know, getting started with something that you really want to do. From my perspective, I have been a corporate junkie for about 12 years, 13 years of my life before I did this. And out of those 13 years, 10 years have been in, you know, entrepreneurial ventures, which are basically, you know, little initiatives slash, you know, projects slash companies that the corporates wanted to start. So after about 10 years of doing that and trying to implement those inside the corporate, there was always this lingering thought saying, hey, can I do this myself? Then it was just a matter of finding the right partner and the right concept to go with. I found one of my batchmates from IIT Bombay, who we met after 15 years when we were working in Honeywell together. So he comes from a completely different perspective. He's from the design background, and I'm from the MBA data background. He's from the creative side. So it was just a matching of the two complementary skill sets, I guess. We just decided to take off. And I don't think we had an idea in mind when we decided. We just, quit our jobs, and on a notice period, we started thinking, hey, what do we do next? So that was the jump that we did. There also has been a lot of frustration within the corporate as well, where, put in a lot of efforts, and then for reasons beyond your control, could be internal politics, could be, stuff that is happening outside that has drastically changed the environment in which you were launching. There has been a lot of, times when a lot of your efforts have gone unnoticed, unrecognized in the market, right? Whereas here it is direct impact. Whatever you do every day matters, both for yourself, your own company, and what you're doing out there. So that has been one big motivator to start up as well.
Thanks for those insights. Effectuation principles plus fun. So, you could start off with the next question I have, or any one of you. Could you list down just two or three qualities that you think you have that have helped you in the entrepreneurial journey? Anything, personal qualities, you think that has helped you? Not about others, about yourself. If it's kind of hard, anyone who has a thought can.
I actually thought of this yesterday. Yes. Because we have our offsite coming.
Two, three qualities.
Three. Yeah. In McKinsey, we do everything in three. Okay. So that kind of stuck on to me. But three things, right? One is, number one has been focus. So it's very important, we were talking about in the previous session. There's a lot of problems you can solve. Yes, I care about Sony World signal being painful. Yes, I care about traffic being bad. Yes, I care about people making better livelihoods, etc. But just pick one thing that you want to solve, make it as narrow as possible, and just focus on it till you find a solution, right? If you will be resource constrained, so be realistic about what resources you have, and try to just keep chipping away and focus. That gives, for you as an individual, that gives a lot of momentum, but also when you start building a team, anything that is not focused could lead to a lot of confusion, and confusion has very cumulative effect once it starts trickling down the team, right? So focus has been one very important thing. Second thing has been integrity and honesty. You have to be honest both to yourself. Like if someone asks me, Yamini, would you like to go and change people's life? Like I was someone who wanted to give UPSC and go into IAS, and I met a few women collectors. My dad wanted to show me the mirror, so he connected me to a few women collectors who said, here is what people call us in meetings. Politicians call us in meetings, and these are extremely bad words. They don't address us by our name. And here are the kinds of scenarios that you have to deal with. We are not saying you don't get into this line. Just be real about whether you are okay to put aside what you personally feel in scenarios like this, and actually act on the problem that you're trying to solve, right? And I just felt I was not mature enough to go through any of that. I was not coached or trained to accept any of that, right? So I wouldn't be effective. So I was realistic. Someone, when I was just leaving McKinsey and thinking of what problem should I focus on solving, I cared about agriculture a lot and food a lot. So Nachiket Moore told me there is these 5,000 cashew nut farmers in Tamil Nadu. Would you like to come and become a CEO and try to get their product the highest buy rates in international markets, package that, brand that, and run this? And it required going to farms, it required doing a lot of like bus traveling to villages, etc. And I was realistic, I just don't like traveling in city buses, that's it, right? So those are simple things, but the reality is, be very honest. These are simple things that I was being honest to myself about, but there are people who have gone and said, I will go and solve that problem because farmers matter a lot to me. And the first city bus or like whatever rural bus they had to take, the first time they had to spend the night in a village, they just felt like it was not worth the
pain, right? And they're already 1 year into their life in this. So I think it's important to be honest to yourself, but more important when you start building a team is being honest to your team. There is nothing that you have when you start up, when some simple things like when someone joins your team and you say, you know what, you're going to do a lot for me and you're going to own 1% of this company, most probably you won't have an ESOP policy in place, most probably you won't have a shareholder pattern in place, most probably none of this is on record, maybe your company is not even registered. It's very easy suddenly when you see success to say, you know, I'm in 1% of ESOP pool. It happened with an entrepreneur in my batch where he was promised 4% and then he was given 4% of an ESOP pool, which was actually only 10% of the whole company, right? That's fraud. And as an entrepreneur, when you have nothing, your word is everything. As a human being, forget about entrepreneurship, even in a company, even in a place like a school, right? Your word is everything. The first time you break your word, you're nothing, right? So the second thing that mattered a lot was this integrity and honesty. And the third thing is openness to listen and take feedback. I am good at many things and I'm very, very proud of that. And I am not so great at many things. When I started Vymo, I was never a people manager. So if I actually give a coaching feedback to someone, it would ruffle a lot of feathers and people would even be willing to quit because I just didn't know what was the right way to do that kind of coaching, right? The first VPs we started hiring actually took me to a room and said, that's not how you do it. This is how you do it. There's a process for telling people that they need to do better. And you have to follow the process because irrespective of what you think of them, that they might be wasting your resource or whatever that is, they are people who have stuck their career and years of their lives committed that to your organization, right? And that was an eye-opener. That was true. I was looking at it from my eyes, not from the person who has committed themselves to the company, right? Because they have actually put their skin in the game. And that completely changed me. But the whole point was I could have, there are scenarios where CEOs have said, you're a VP, mind your business. I pay you, you don't pay me, right? Or there are scenarios where you say, oh my God, now I know what the problem is. If I fix this, I'm going to have a fantastic team. I'm going to fix this and I'm going to fix myself, right? So focus, honesty, and
clarity, openness of openness.
And willingness to, you're not, just start by saying that you know nothing. You know a few things that you're going to latch on to and then you're going to learn everything else from others.
Rachna, you want to add something?
Yeah, so I have three as well. So I think the personal qualities, right, which I think were essential to do a startup. The first thing I think is for me was to be okay with the failure scenario. I mean, this is true even when I was at Zynga managing, you know, games like Farmville and all of that. Work towards success, but tell yourself that it's okay, you know, to fail, like acceptable loss, right, which Professor Kumar spoke about, because otherwise it gets too stressful. So I've always told myself that I'll do everything I possibly can to make this succeed. But I mean, it's not the end of the world if it doesn't. At least I know I've given it my best. And I think that's very important for entrepreneurs to keep in mind. The second one is, I think, obsessive attention to detail. Every use case matters, especially if it's a technology product. Think about every possible use case, every possible test case, because there is, you know, in the early stage especially, you know, every user counts, right? And you don't want anyone having a substandard experience on your product. So obsessive attention to detail, I think, is very important. And thirdly, I would say don't take yourself too seriously, because there's a lot you'll have to do as an entrepreneur, which you wouldn't do in a corporate job, right? So I have spent many hours standing in the sun on installs. I just got to know that Mr. Partha met me in a stall like this a few years back. I have made deliveries to offices. So we did a corporate experiment last year and we didn't have money to buy, you know, to hire delivery boys. And we didn't want to also. We were like, let's do it ourselves. So the three founders were the delivery people. I used to joke that I'm probably the only delivery girl in Bangalore delivering lunch to offices. And we learned a lot through those experiments. So, you know, don't take yourself too seriously because you just have to be open to doing everything and anything in your startup. And only then you will learn. We've also personally met more than 500 home sellers ourselves. And the insights we got from those meetings were just phenomenal. I mean, now we know exactly how our users think. And that's really important. So that step, unfortunately, just cannot be eliminated. It has to be a part of the process.
Ganesh, you want to?
Sure.
A couple of qualities.
So I have two, not three. one of them is, like Rachna said, do whatever it takes. This is something that I learned through my journey as an entrepreneur.
we've done one startup that did not work, one that was working decently well, but the other one was working better. So we were hedging our bets. So eventually we closed that down as well. So one of them was an e-commerce for, you know, organic and specialty foods. And as Rachna said, we were doing deliveries every day. And yeah, I was probably the only guy who was driving an AC car to deliver food to houses. During Momo early days, you know, all of us had a challenge to get, you know, at least 10 users to use our app, 10 new users to use our app. So every evening after our, you know, 10-hour day, 12-hour day, in the evening, everybody would go out to restaurants where Momo was accepted. Momo is a payments app where you can pay at restaurants and retail stores. So we used to go into the restaurants and, you know, talk to people on the tables, asking them to download the app. I have run a chai stall outside Flipkart for a couple of days to promote the app. We ran a campaign called Haiki Chai. In the company, whether it was hiring, whether it was, you know, HR, admin, cleaning the office every morning, you know, fixing the table when it was broken, to, you know, running the marketing, everything had to be done and somebody had to do it. Nobody else was there. It was just us. So that whatever it takes mindset is needed. There is no job too small or too big. We just need to get it done. That was one. Second is trust. I think when we were building our team, you know, in consulting, I was at Bain for a brief time. We are taught to be great individual contributors, but there is also a big element of trust that I built along the entrepreneurship journey, where you don't have time to do everything in the world. Your biggest constraint is time. And at some point in time, you need to recruit the right people and trust them to do what they have to do. And giving that autonomy and, you know, then helping them along the way to make things happen is really critical. Otherwise, you will burn out very quickly as an entrepreneur. So that is something that I do better, I think.
Yeah, Saumil? The Binda's attitude and fun.
Yes, that's already taken, so I'll take two more. Building on what they said, I think the failure part is an important piece, but I think the critical thing is after failure, what? Is the real thing, right? After failure, I can react quickly and fix quickly. To me, I think the speed of this closing the cycle of do, fail, therefore what, therefore do, fail, is almost like an iterative cycle where you get better every time. You can't take 5 years to say, okay, now I failed, now what do I do? It has to be in months, days, weeks. So that's one thing that I think has worked for me in hindsight. And therefore, in my case, for example, from 98 when I started becoming an entrepreneur till 2008 almost, multiple ventures failed. The only thing I realized was time is a significantly undervalued commodity that entrepreneurs have. We value expertise, we value funding, we don't value our time that you need to give a venture. So for me, that was one key thing that I came brought into this SportzVillage context. The other piece was serendipity. Serendipity is a word that I learned when I was mugging for GRE. my batchmate in IIT said the way to learn serendipity is when you're looking for a needle in a haystack and you find the farmer's daughter. So how do you enable serendipity? Because you only have so many resources. So how do you go out to networks? Do you go out and meet people? Go out and find people who are not like you? How do you find long hops? People who are just unlike you, but have a conversation that suddenly they show you a mirror that you've never seen for yourself and for your business. They open networks that would never have otherwise opened. So I think time and serendipity are two things that I think are in our control. It's not about the market. It's not about funding. It's not about anything else. It's about what you can do. And I think that's probably been the two big things.
So the next question to you, Saumil. You mentioned about failures. So what actually happens, most of you would have, it's not going to be a curve that keeps going upwards. It's a roller coaster ride. And what happens to you when something actually fails, doesn't meet your expectations, when you have to close something? As an entrepreneur, the analytics comes later. The logic of analyzing, etc. What happens to you at the emotional level? What are you thinking? Would you go back and be able to share? Yeah.
It sucks. Failure sucks. Failure is not fun.
Yeah.
It's a deeply intense experience. And I think most of the people in this room, given the backgrounds, have never failed. Mm. You might have done badly in exams. you might not have dated the girl or the guy you wanted, but beyond that, you've not really failed.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you've more or less achieved your objectives most of the time.
Yeah.
Maybe 70, 80, 90%, 95%, depending on what. So this whole notion of failure is a theoretical construct for most of us. Even in jobs, you'll achieve 50, 60, 70% of your goals. You never fail. Even if you get fired, you'll think, I did 60%, company said 80%, therefore I got fired. But you never failed. But the failure in a venture is very stark. I mean, you can't negotiate with it. That's what it is. I mean, you can't pay your bills, employees are leaving, and you know, you're done. So it's an extremely intense experience.
So what are the kind of thinking that probably helps you in getting out of the muck? Anything that you'd like to share?
So one is, when you face venture has failed, I have not failed.
Okay.
Right? I'm not a failure, the venture has failed.
Sure.
And to that, the related point is that the parameters for success, there is such a high level of entropy in the world outside that you are trying, in that high entropy system, trying to find a product market fit for a product that doesn't exist, very often for a market that doesn't exist. I mean, you're playing odds at the last extreme.
Yeah.
So let's accept that the reason you entrepreneurs make a lot of money is because you're taking a very, very high risk, high return game. And we only think of the high return.
Yeah.
The failure rate is the manifestation of the high risk.
Yeah.
But we never think of high risk. In fact, if you tell entrepreneurs high risk, the first response is, yeah, that's for everybody else. I am the stud. The 98% mortality doesn't apply to me. I am the 2%. If everybody thinks that 2%, somebody is 98%, no? Everybody cannot be the 2%. So there is this alpha male, alpha female thing that comes out. The moment you say, don't worry, it's the high risk thing, and you're like, no, I'll do it. You are an idiot. I was the stud around here. So there is this, maybe you need to be foolish. Maybe. So partly foolishness, how do you come out of it? One is failure of the venture, not you. And I think who you are with, your ecosystem is a very important thing. How does the family react? How does how do your friends react? Those are very important pieces.
Yeah. Ganesh, would you like to also take this question? If you went through something earlier which didn't really work out.
Yeah, so we ran a company called Windsleep Technologies straight out of our corporate jobs.
Okay.
Ran it for about 8 months and didn't work, so we shut it down. So interesting.
Does blame
aspect
happen?
Of that.
When something fails, and if you have a set of co-founders, or do you start blaming each other? Is it very tempting to start finding scapegoats for something not working? Have you gone through?
No, we were blaming ourselves more than others.
Okay.
There is a lot of, it's a very humbling experience for sure. You know, as Saumil said, you know, you're IIT, IIM graduates, you're the 0.01% of all people who ever gave these exams. And you're supposed to be smart, you're supposed to figure this out. And, you know, when it doesn't work, suddenly, you know, you're stuck in a place where you've got no income at home, you've got an infant, two EMIs, and, you know, what else. Very humbling experience. I think that was the first time I genuinely understood what it means, what humbleness means. Or humility means, and it's a so outside of the introspection and trying to figure out what went wrong. I think the way what helped us come out was focusing on what next. Okay, now we have learned from this. How do we make sure that we don't repeat this again? How do we learn from this and make something better and find a suitable opportunity that will actually work, right? So that focus on what next worked very well. And of course, the support system. I really think,
family support.
Yeah. I know a lot of friends whose family has not been very supportive of their efforts. Even if their startup is doing well, they have been under deep turmoil. And they have ended up quitting and getting back into their corporate jobs. Sometimes it leads to an ethical dilemma as well. People have siphoned money out of their companies because of family pressures. So unless there is a family support and unless, there is somebody out there telling you, no matter what, just go ahead and do what you have to do. That is extremely essential for you to come back.
So what I'm hearing is resilience. Businesses fail, entrepreneurs don't. So, okay. And now the next question is for the women panelists. Do you think there are some qualities that women have, which probably is you're at a better advantage in terms of, absorbing the emotional stresses in an entrepreneurial journey? Or are there other qualities you think women have an advantage or disadvantage vis-a-vis men, gender-based?
So I think, I definitely think there are a couple of advantages, and I've seen that with working mothers who have been successful. So I've seen that they have very little time, including myself. I have a 3.5-year-old son. Very, very little time. So the way we prioritize is brutal. You just don't have time for anything that is not going to add value, significant value. Like, okay, you'll have this conversation only if it's worth $1 million kind of stuff, right? So I think we are extremely brutal in prioritizing, and that gives a lot of focus to the teams also. So that's definitely true. I think there is one advantage I think I have. I don't think many people will agree. But after having seen my son and how irrational, how demanding a kid can be when they're like one, and like you might be having a fever, running up a fever, but the kid wants what he wants, otherwise he's going to raise hell, right? After seeing that kind of behavior firsthand, somehow it just seems to me that anyone else who's throwing a tantrum, I just have a very different worldview. You'll get over it, right? And that includes anyone, like client throwing a tantrum, team throwing a tantrum. It's like, because it's a son, it's a boy, I think men throwing tantrums somehow 100% for me fall into that category, right?
I get it,
what you're going through. Because when a baby's throwing a tantrum, it's usually diaper, food, or sleep, right? So you're trained to do so much of diaper, food, sleep. What is this? One of the three. Are you hungry? Are you sleepy? Did you just poo? Right? No. So the point is, you're trained so much in 1 year, so intensely. It happens like 6 times a day, 8 times a day, right? Then when you go back to the office and someone is going through something, you just try to think of, it has to be one of it. The list of three could be something different. The list of three could be something different. They're stressed about their career. They're stressed about their family. They're stressed about their paycheck. They're stressed about their own success or their own resume or whatever that is, but they're stressed about something. And once you isolate that root cause, you focus less on the tantrum and more on the root cause. And it happens even with clients. Clients have, Vymo drives sales impact, right? So usually we have CEO visibility. Every launch that we do at client organizations, CEOs usually message me saying, Yamini, I have set expectations with my board that this is magically going to solve our problems, which is unrealistic, but still they have that expectation, right? So when they are stressed, usually it's helpful to understand their context. You have a board, okay, you went and committed something. Now that might be absolutely stupid, but the only way you are going to get out of this is if I support you to try to get through at least halfway of that, right? So I think, that's two secret advantages I definitely have.
So
nothing gruffles me too
you're
much.
You're learning from your three-year-old child. Applying it on adults. Thanks.
So I actually feel gender is irrelevant, because I think it would be unfair to say that, you know, women have an edge because of empathy. Because I've seen very empathetic men. I've seen very non-empathetic women. I've seen a lot of men with amazing attention to detail. I personally don't think it's relevant, actually.
Here's the last question before we get into Q&A. What has the entrepreneurial journey done to you as a person? Have you changed pre-entrepreneurship and post? What has it done to you as a person? Not in terms of what you're doing. In your own context, you could be doing whatever you are. As a person, how have you changed? Saumil, you want to take the question?
So it's given me a lot of fun. But change as a person, I think, exposed me to the wonderful variety of people who are out there. Growing up, you do end up staying in one silo. Whatever your background is, whatever educational background, you end up staying with that silo, and very often you don't get opportunities to go beyond it. Even your work trajectory pretty much tends to stay in one socioeconomic silo.
Absolutely.
I think entrepreneurship has introduced me to good and bad, all all kinds of people. So I think a lot more aware of the world. And also a lot more sensitive to how the economic undercurrents run the world.
Okay.
which earlier I was slightly, in my mind, at least for me, was slightly insensitive to.
Yeah.
That a lot of the money, the watch the money flow and you'll see the behavior flow.
Okay.
Instead of, earlier I would analyze the behavior and give a moral judgment. The moment you ask the money flow, like he said, the like Professor said, the coconut vendor driving.
Yeah.
First it will be like, you know what, this guy is not following rules.
Yeah.
Now you start thinking differently. He has a customer on the other side. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so it just changed the way you analyze the world, and hopefully that is more.
And your worldview has probably changed too, the way you look at the world.
I think hopefully
then,
more, definitely more sympathetic to entrepreneurs.
And empathetic.
Yeah, I mean, you go to a restaurant, I will not sit at a 6-table seat because I know is losing, this guy is losing business if I'm alone.
Yes.
I will go and find a 2-table so that I reduce his loss as a. You know the other guys, you know the P&L, you know what's going to happen.
And there's probably an appreciation for what someone else is going through. Yeah. Yeah, okay, fine. Ganesh, one of you, anyone?
So, bunch of things. Again, I think I always come up with the number three, but anyway, I'll start listing them out. One is definitely starting, again, at McKinsey, we used to be trained a lot on strength, focusing on strengths versus weaknesses. But I think in entrepreneurship, that comes to the fore because resources are constrained. You have people who are committed, who care a lot about your cause also. They may not be perfect, but they have some strengths. And if you focus on that, it actually takes you a very, very long way. The second thing is internal scorecard versus external scorecard. I think, we're mentally tuned, including GPS system, whatever that is, right? Throughout life, reviews at corporates, etc. To have and react to an external scorecard and realign yourself. I think entrepreneurship more than anything else has made me an internal scorecard person because I've realized, not actually during the startup, but I realized not during the tough times, but during the most successful times, like my peak of my career at McKinsey, where probably I was one of the best rated paid engagement managers, or time when Vymo raised funding and publicly we were successful, though internally we always believed we were successful. It's like optimistic world. But during the peak times also, during the peak times, you actually realize, and during the tough times, you realize who really is a friend, who really is not a friend, how people react to these things. For example, you might have been a DML, someone called you Maggu, right? And there are ways in people in which your world reacts to you amongst your closest circle and community, right? And at some point, I think over a period of time, you just start filtering out these people, these comments, etc. And internal scorecard becomes most important. So these are the two things which I think have changed dramatically.
Ganesh?
I think I've learned to cut out the bullshit a lot.
Okay.
One thing that MBA school teaches you, a lot of jargon. I don't think it matters at all. Now we just focus on the most important thing and get right to the point. That is one thing that is very critical. I don't have time for anything else, right? That is one thing that I've learned. The second thing is value system. I have understood my own value system much more since I've got on this journey. I know where my line is, and I know which line I cannot cross, because there are so many, you know, opportunities that come along which, you know, need you to step across the line, or, you know, compel you to step across the line. But if you know exactly where you stand, that helps a lot in making your decision clear. According to me, even if you're trying to look for a co-founder, more than anything else, if your value systems are aligned, then everything else can just work out. That's one thing I've learned the hard way as well. Yeah.
Sure. Rachna, you want to share something?
I think you just become very thick-skinned, because especially when the success happens, it's great. I mean, everyone's happy and cheering and, hey, I knew you'll, you know, be successful and all of that. But during the hard times when you're just sitting, you're working from home and you're not meeting too many people and you're just, you know, like, you know, working away at it, that's when, you know, a lot of people have random opinions, you know. So, like, a lot of people I met, and I would tell them what I'm working on, and they would be confused. And then my mom will be like, you know, she went to IIMB. And then they'll get more confused. Because, like, some social proof is needed that, you know, she's smart. But, and then they'll get more, this uncle once asked me, you went to IIMB, why are you doing this? And I was like, oh my God, you just missed the whole point, right? I mean,
that's why you're doing it.
Exactly. You just learn to become very thick-skinned, and you just do what you have to do, and hopefully things will work out for the best.
Saumil, you had a point?
I realized these four words, I think, have been the biggest takeaway, which is this too shall pass.
Oh, yeah.
See, everybody. Because you stared down the barrel so many times, and you've gone broke, businesses, clients have run away, teams have run away, investors have backed out, and you find at the end of it, you're still there, your friends are still there, your family is still there.
Yeah.
People don't know what shit is going on at the back. You know, this too shall pass. I mean, like they say, like a kidney stone.
You become
pass,
a Zen. A Zen monk. The Zen monk. Yeah. Now we'll open it up to the audience for Q&A. Any questions to a specific panelist, you could address it. Or to all of them, you could do that too. Yeah, I think I'll require your help.
Hi, everyone. This is Deepak. So the questions to any of the panel members. When you decided, you all are corporate junkies, right? And after certain point, you decided to quit the job and start your own venture. So now, what are the key thoughts you want to put in structure so that it will help you in your venture, start venture?
So I think someone asked me this when I had all these amazing ideas on, you know, baby food is going to be a big thing, online clothes are going to be a big thing, etc. My husband told me, what do you know? What do you know that will give you a distinctive advantage? Because you are doing this, not someone else. What do you know about baby food? Like, we did not even have a kid at that time, right? Or what do you know about clothes? You are not that fashionable. I can give you direct feedback. So I think is the number one thing. If you're planning to do something, what is it that you know that will give you an advantage that no one else or very few others would have? And then it's a matter of how things pan out over time, but it has to be this. For me, that was the starting point.
So I reached a point where I realized that my resume is not going to get any better than this. So it was like, now maybe I should do something that I really want to do. Honestly, at some point in time, your mind switches from saying, you know, is earning your next salary the most important thing, or doing what you like to do the most important thing? And that's when you make the jump. Opportunity cost calculations don't work. We are taught to do that all the time. But it does not work. It's an emotional decision to either do it or not. It usually works out. So.
I actually ask myself one question when I'm making life-changing decisions, right? Whether it's getting married, moving countries, quitting job. So when I'm 60, will I regret not doing this? And can I afford to do it? And if you really think that this is going to be your life's largest regret, right? I think for me, that makes it easier to make these large life-saving decisions, because I don't think the math will really make sense. Like, it won't be a logical thing to do given your corporate job and all of that.
Thank you.
He referred to opportunity cost. I have used this framework of opportunity cost or not doing it. Not from a passion point of view and live your dream, the touchy-feely mother of apple pie state, but more from a financial point of view that end of the day, when the venture works, when the venture hits a product market fit, the capital appreciation of your stock will more than compensate for all the years of opportunity cost. So even financially, it makes sense. If you give it enough time. The problem is very often we think of 2, 3, 4 years as a time horizon. And those 2, 3, 4 years multiplied by X lakhs a month, multiplied by 12, suddenly you're like, oh my God. Right? And that's very often also happens at the same time you're getting married, same time you're having kids. So there's also this sense of, am I failing my family? There's lots of other stuff that's going on. It's not only you. So that's one thing that opposite of not doing it, where you make a lot of money and you have a successful venture and you did something you loved. Now, that's worth doing. That's one thing. The other part on what she, I slightly disagree with her in terms of whether it's your starting expertise or not, because I found, like, I started my first business in computer training. I had never done anything. Then sports, I played, but I don't know anything about sports as a business. What I also found is that the world beyond the point is willing to give you the benefit of doubt. Maybe it's because you have an IIMB degree or otherwise. Other is the level of depth in the market for anything is so low. You spend 6 months in it, you'll become an expert. The depth is just not there. So even if you don't have the context, let's say you like mountaineering and you've never, you know, not really done it. Spend 6 months, I'm telling you, you'll be counted as an expert. You'll be in panel discussion like this talking about mountaineering. but that's the reality.
It's evident that entrepreneurs go through a lot of toll in the sense that they have been pulled in multiple directions by themselves, if not others. So my question is, how do you unwind yourselves to come back to normal and start the day again? Is there anything that really makes you to be like that? Or of course, the physical exercise and the being spiritual will help you. But anything else that can help to come back to normalcy?
You look very stressed at this point.
So my, you know, I play a lot. So I know my wife, whenever I get cranky at home, she says, go and play it tomorrow morning.
Okay.
And then I get less cranky. So I think all of us have our own stuff. What works for me is play and some quiet time with the book.
Yeah, like I have a personal goal of 50 books a year. I did 38 last year. But fantasy fiction is what I read, so it takes you into a very different world. Then kid, a little bit of relief, not too much, but for a short period, that's a good relief. And then once in a quarter, vacations. Vacations are pretty intense. You switch off everything and you go to a no connectivity zone. So it helps you think, and actually it helps you come up with better ideas.
Yeah, I think you should. It's important to keep time to do what you enjoy. You know, some fitness is important because it's very easy to like say, I'll skip my workout and work for another hour and get more done. But I think especially as you enter your 30s, it's very, very important to give time for physical fitness as well, because if you're, you know, if health fails you, then there's no point. And keep a day every week, ideally, to like just switch off and do stuff that, you know, guilty pleasures. Just keep one day for that, ideally. It's not always possible.
But I do also want to point out that you get joy from the work you're doing. You actually get positive energy because you're doing what you like to do and it's challenging enough. So it's not that you have stress. I mean, you might have stress for other reasons, because you're not paying your bills at home and all that. No. But the business actually gives you positive energy.
Yeah, it's not about the stress, but still, human is a system. Like, you can't be energetic as long as you would like to. That's not possible. So you need to, yeah, need not be. So all that, finally, it boils down to you do what you love to do. So that gives you a lot of benefit to come back to normals. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, we'll take an online question. Given a chance to turn back time, would you all have gone for entrepreneurship right after college? Or in other words, let me rephrase this. We heard the professor talk about affordable loss, about risk taking. You know, when you started your entrepreneurial journey, did you have some, one is timeline, that I work my butt off for 1 year or 1.5 years, 2 years, and if it doesn't work, I go back. That's number one. Number two, in terms of money, this is the X rupees that I'm going to spend. Beyond that, Lakshman Rekha, I go back, right? Is there something on those lines that you think about? Did you have some metrics?
I didn't have specific numbers, but I think there was this whole internal conflict becoming higher and higher and bank balance becoming higher and higher. And suddenly at some point, you're saying, okay, that's it. The question also asked specifically, would you have started right after college? Different people are different types. I think there have been many successful entrepreneurs who are even college dropouts, right? I mean, obviously some of the most successful ones, in fact. So I think it's more of your persona. Know what causes stress or gives you the comfort.
He says without savings.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what. Exactly. So that's what. So that different people are of different sorts. Different people can endure different levels of stuff. For me, I think I'm very happy with having started with a certain amount of savings in the bank, because it took me a little bit of time to get back to that level again as part of Vymo. Meanwhile, it gave my family the ability to do things they liked also. Just because I was starting up, they didn't have to go through tremendous amount of sacrifices, etc. Right? And then then we took turns. Once I stabilized, they went, like my husband started his own hedge fund, etc. So I think it gave us the flexibility. Without, probably it would have been a lot more stressful if that wasn't the case. But also I think my experience helped me in getting to what I really wanted to solve for. So I think it's every person has a different answer.
I can speak with authority on no savings, because I hit rock bottom multiple times.
I'll join you.
But the operating principle I had was there is a certain life living standard I need to provide my family. It might not be going to Switzerland every month, but I could go to Goa every year and still manage that. And the reality is that given this, at least people in this room, providing that is not really a problem. You could work part-time, and I've done that. I've consulted with friends from 9 to 12 and then done SportzVillage in the evening. We've done all kind of other stuff, which is not related to sport, but you do that to pay your bills. And so it doesn't have to be an all-in. So there is a cash, because after a point, it's a cash flow problem. It's not a, you know, it's actually a cash flow problem. Do you have enough cash to support kids' education, some breaks, some living standards? And beyond a point, it's possible for 15 years.
I had entered campus with a specific mindset that I need to get up on the corporate ladder, and that's what I ended up doing for the next 5 years. So it entirely depends on your mindset. If you want to do it right out of college, do it right out of college. Don't wait. I did not have that mindset, so I didn't. So as simple as that.
Yeah, a little experience definitely helps.
Some kind of savings in the bank to take care of your basic expenses.
I do. Savings working, like I worked in Wipro for a few years. That has been the asset for me. Yeah. Just the philosophy, the culture, the value system, and the network has been a huge asset.
And also, I think you learn what you like and what you don't like. Yeah, many people actually rule out this whole corporate world as one beast that I will never fit in, etc. But even playing a part of being a part of that, you realize a lot about yourself and what you may or may not enjoy. So whether the startup succeeds or fails, you know, you even know what you want your culture to look like, where you want your startup to go. So on and so forth, because you have done some of this. But I think every person has a different, like, I mean, Facebook end of the day. So sure. I don't think there's a standard.
Any questions from the audience?
Yeah. I just have a very quick, rapid fire question to each of you. Just think back on, you know, a difficult time and something that somebody said which kind of, you know, reinforced your own belief that you just need to continue. Just talking about the people who are part of your support ecosystem.
So, when Windsleep did not work, I used to just hate get up in the morning. So, my wife used to just get up and get out of the house was the one thing that she used to tell me. That worked a lot. Just the fact that you were out and had to do something out there helped me getting back on track. Yeah.
We had the circle of fire, internal feedback, everyone giving feedback in our leadership team thing. When someone said, Yamini, I think the reason we have come from zero to one is probably because you're willing to do whatever it takes to just pull the company through the next step, right? I didn't consciously think I was doing that, but now that someone has said it, I feel compelled to do it every single time. So it just keeps driving me on, yeah.
So I think one of the things I haven't mentioned about FoodyBuddy is we connect buyers and sellers of home-cooked food in large apartment communities without a delivery network. So we don't have a delivery or logistics network. We said we will make this work without that. It'll be only tech and product. And in 2016, things weren't going like very well. It worked very well in one or two apartment communities, didn't work in a whole string of them. And then we just said, you know, let's stop launching in more apartments. Let's just sit down and figure it out. And it was like a very... definitely a very dark time. And I think my husband, who's also one of my co-founders, both of us have been on this full time since 2016 with a third co-founder. So he said, I mean, if it was an easy problem to solve, it would have been figured out by now, right? It's not easy. So if we believe, if three of us really believe that this needs to happen, then let's figure it out. And I think, it's really important to surround yourself with a support system and very good co-founders, because I don't think any of us has mentioned it till now, but I think having supportive co-founders is like very, very important.
So, in my case, I think when I first quit Wipro and decided to go on this path, I, with some dread, called up my dad and said, you know what, I'm quitting. And I was expecting a different reaction, and he said, great, all the best. And then he said, what are you going to do? And to me, the order of the two statements was very important. It was not that after he understood whether what I was doing was good enough, that he said, all the best. First was, I know you'll figure it out. He said, by the way, I mean, what are you going to do? So I think some of these things give you the underlying confidence that there are other people also who have confidence that you'll figure it out. And some of the degrees that all of us have, finally, what is it? It's a social proof, as you call it, to say you'll figure it out. You might not be able to, But you get a benefit of doubt that you'll figure it out.
So this is the one last question.
So this is the thing, actually. What is the importance of having a backup plan? What is the importance of having a backup plan, actually? Because you have an MBA degree. I don't have, I'm not from IIT, and I don't have any MBA degree. So if it is like I fail, I won't be able to get a job or something, okay? So what would be the source of income after that? And that's the thing, how do you figure it out? What is the importance of having some backup plan, how you would make it and all that?
According to me, a backup plan does not work because if you have a backup plan, you'll think about the backup plan more than what you're actually doing. And you will end up doing the backup plan anyway. Entrepreneurship, you have to go all in on your plan A and do whatever it takes to make it work. That's the only way.
So, as you said, being realistic, though, how would you be realistic if you're saying this?
Actually, do not. If anyone tells me that they will continue their job but also consult with Vymo on the side, etc., none of this really works. Like for me, I was on McKinsey leave of absence because they said, don't quit, at least figure out what you want to do. I said, okay, that's smart enough thing to think about. So I had 6 months leave of absence. 2 months into it, I knew what I would do. The first thing I did was put in my papers. So everyone at McKinsey said, let it be successful. Why don't you raise funding? You technically are still, you can come back anytime to the job, right? And my life, if I have to come back, I'll come back. And I know you'll accept me. So I don't need that, the fact that there is a safety net. It's best not to have a safety net. For me, I think I actually feel the commitment to trying to succeed and making it work is much higher in that scenario. But genuinely, we are not saying it just because it's nice to hear, but backup plans are BS.
So I've been an entrepreneur as well, inside a corporate running a startup-y kind of a environment. But guess what? Even if when you're in that environment, what is the worst that will happen? If the idea does not work, you still have your paycheck. You will go into some other role in the company. You're not losing your job. But when you're in an entrepreneurial journey, if it does not work, it is a matter of survival. And survival makes you do things that you will never do otherwise. The amount of risk appetite that you have, the amount of initiative that you can have when you are, battling a survival scenario is something that will push you to do things that will make things work no matter what, right? You cannot have a backup plan, according to me, again.
I must violently disagree. You're asking the question of backup plan to people who already have backup plans. I mean, the degrees is a backup plan. The fact that you'll get a job is a backup plan. It already exists. Wherever you work, they'll take us back. So we already have a backup plan. So you're asking us to imagine we already have it. Right? Now, to me, the backup plan or not depends on when your cash hits zero. The day you hit zero cash in your personal bank balance is the point of the decision. Till that time, you have backup. Right? Whether it's by debt, equity, personal saving, till that time, it's all backup. At that point, what do you do? And my view is, think of time as a backup. It doesn't have to be that your venture has to go from 0 to 100 in the next 12 months. If you don't have cash, let it go in 36 months. But stay the course. And the 36 months means you have to pay your bills by doing a part-time consulting. Well, so be it. Let the idea continue. As against going into this, if we do it, we'll go out in a blaze of glory or else we'll not do it. I don't buy that. If you think it's worth doing, do it. Let it take 5 more years. Let it take 10 more years. At some point, it will work, assuming the idea makes sense.
I actually think that while you're doing your startup, you need to be all in. But in terms of a backup plan, I think you need to make sure you're employable at the end of it, if it doesn't work out. Which is why I think the earlier question, right, would I recommend doing a startup straight out of college? I would actually say no. Yes, it helps with bank balance. It helps with experience, two very important points. But thirdly, it also makes sure that you have some relevant experience, which makes you employable again if your startup fails. Yeah, maybe at least you don't have to start as a fresher, right? You'll maybe start again with the batch that was 2 years your junior or whatever. But I just think that after a failed startup, to find a job again, if that's what you want to do, it's just easier if you have some experience before that.
I think we'll have to ask for more because we are really running short of time, and it's been wonderful having this discussion. A lot of insight into. A
lot of insights into how entrepreneurs think, how do they behave under stressful conditions, trust, integrity, focus, clarity of thought, fun. A lot of these adjectives are proper. I mean, you know, proper in your mind when you reflect back on the discussion that we had just now. And it's thanks to all of you for having come and, you know, shared your insights with all of us. We have a small memento from sponsored by NSR SED. The wonderful ladies out here are the alumni office team, part of the alumni office team, who do a lot of support at the back end for all our activities. And I request all of you to keep visiting the campus on some pretext or the other. We will create the context and you just come. Okay, yeah. And thank you so much. Thank you so much. So before we break for tea, a couple of quick reminders in terms of the program schedule. We have today two things for you. Number one is a person who couldn't join us today, Sanjay Anandram, 91 batch. He's also a board member of TIE and advisor in iSpirit. He has written a book called Startup Mantras, very insightful book. It's free for everyone out here. It's downloadable ebook version. All you need to do is visit newsletter.imba.org and go to this link, download Startup Mantras, and you can download it as a ebook. From tomorrow, the link will be off. Okay, that is one. Number two is there is also tea waiting out there for all of us. We'll have a quick 20 minutes break and then assemble back again. And we also have a book on sale, Unmet Needs Entrepreneurship. I am the author. Thank you all.